Hi everyone, welcome to our seminar. Today we have Lavanya Ramakrishnan. I'm not sure if I pronounce your last name correct. If not, sorry for that. Lavanya is a senior scientist and division deputy in the Scientific Data Division at LBL. She started in the lab in 2009, and of course she's the Alvarez Fellow at that time. And she has also served as a group lead for the Usable Software System Group. Her research interests are in building software tools for computational and data-intensive science with a focus on workflow, resource, and data management. More recently, she has been using user research methods to understand as well as verify or validate the context of use and social challenges that often impact tool design and development. She currently leads a number of project teams that consist of a mix of social scientists, software engineers, and computer scientists. With that, I'd like to leave the virtual stage to Lavanya.
Thanks, Jackie. Thanks for that introduction. And thanks everybody today for joining in. I see we have a small crowd here, so I'm hoping we can get a little bit interactive. And you can ask me questions. Small crowds are easier sometimes because we can actually have some discussions, but we'll see how it goes as we go along here. So today what I'm going to do is talk a little bit about scientific workflows and sort of give you a little bit of history of how that field of scientific workflows has evolved, emerged and evolved, and is where it's headed in the long term. And sort of tied my research in that story a little bit. So you're going to hear bits and pieces of sort of an overview, as well as some of the research that happens in here at Berkeley Lab and with our collaborators. So in terms of how I got to where I am, I know I was told I should talk a few minutes about this. I started out as a master's student in Indiana University. Went and then worked as a software engineer in research environments in North Carolina for a few years. And I used to meet my advisor all the time at conferences and workshops, and he convinced me to go back for a PhD. And so I have a little bit of an unusual path where I worked and did various things while I was doing my PhD. And then I joined Berkeley Lab as an Alvarez Fellow. And have sort of built my career here over the last, I guess, 13, 14 years or so. So my research is in tools that sit between users and the infrastructure, mainly looking at sort of workflow, resource, and data management on distributed and HPC systems. Jackie talked a little bit about my team being sort of a diverse group of systems researchers, software engineers, as well as HCI specialists. So I'm going to tell you why that is important today. So I expect many of you are already familiar with the data challenges facing our scientific facilities and collaborations. Berkeley Lab is a DOE-funded national lab and home to many user facilities. Each of our facilities are producing and managing large amounts of data, but also complex software and processing. And scientific advances increasingly rely on the ability of researchers to use the data in a high-performance computing infrastructure to operate on that data that's produced by these experiments, observations, and simulations to gain that insight that leads to publications and impact in society. The key question so my team tries to address is, how do we enable researchers to effectively and efficiently manage their computation and data? That is, how do they manage their data and their workflows on future networks, HPC architectures? How do we support sort of the new emerging workflows such as iterative, interactive, exploratory, AI, ML, self-driving, automated, all these various workflows that are coming up? How do you sort of capture the end-to-end scientific process so we have reproducibility? How do you do data and workflow sharing, search, and reuse in our environments so we have an effective science environment? So the way we address our these problems in my group is taking sort of a dual approach. And we work very closely with the application scientists in developing methods and tools to manage their data and workflows. And we work very closely with the system software that runs on these large-scale systems, whether that's distributed systems or HPC, and work closely with HPC center staff to understand how the next generation systems should be designed. But more importantly, we came to the realization that to address these problems, we need to sort of engage in user research, where user research gives you a process to verify and validate your intuition about what the user needs. It's sort of like an hypothesis, and then trying to convert what you learn from the users about their needs into an actionable set of output that enriches their experience on these systems. And this, this is unusual a little bit for our environments because it's sort of bringing in social scientists, ethnographers to work closely with both the users as well as our science team. So if you don't, have a hard time following any of these things, please stop and ask me questions. But this is sort of the high level elevator pitch of what my research is about. So where did scientific workflows emerge? So sort of in the early 2000s, many scientific communities had complex processing, and the notion of having specifying these dependencies came along. So workflows were a concept in the business community well before that. If you looked at sort of various inventory management systems, process management systems, things like that, where people were assigned specific tasks and there was a workflow that it went through. There was a huge number of sort of science problems that were different just based on the ecosystem, but also the complex software stacks. And people sort of, there was an emergence of workflow tools that came out where many of these tools were very domain specific, sort of trying to solve this problem of how do you distribute the work across multiple machines, gather the results and potentially redistribute or do more analysis. So a directed acyclic graph has been used to represent and manage workflows in many of these workflow tools. And it's sort of the core of a lot of what the community does. And if you look at this, we take a very simplistic view of what the data is. The data is a simple arrow, which magically connects these processes together. And I'd say some of most of the focus in the early days was sort of how do you get the data to where it needs to be? And that was it, right? Because it was largely computational workflows that were looking at, doing large computation on HPC or high performance clusters. So the focus was largely on just, moving the data, getting the data to the right place, and just having things be distributed and run together. So there's some key things to elements here to remember this model of workflows. The workflow tools have been closer to the applications and domain, and their focus is varied based on the needs of a particular domain. And for a lot of this, the infrastructure was a black box, right? So everyone assumed that nothing would change at the HPC center. And so they had to work with that batch queue system and things like that. There's also a little bit, and I'm going to come to it later in my talk as well. Workflow was designed as a productivity construct, right? So, but as a community, if you look at us systems researchers and or facilities that run different things, performance is an important metric. So there's sort of this little bit of a dance around productivity and performance that happens in these workflow tools. But we today in 2022, we are in a different world from where this started in 2000s. And we have AI for science that has emerged as a key area of focus for DOE Office of Science. So there's a lot of focus on how do you make the data AI ready? How do you make sure that's stored and managed and not just lifetime of a project, beyond the project and possibly even decades? And how do you make it, how do you have the FAIR principles reflected in the data? So these issues sort of change how you look at the scientific workflow. It's becoming more and more important to preserve and expand that access to the critical data, but data becomes much more of a focus with the compute sort of looking like it's an additional part for that data. There's also a lot of focus more recently on connecting facilities and field sites to DOE resources. So how do you bring the model and the data together? How do you sort of use edge computing to provide an opportunity and a challenge? So the scientific workflow problem, it started out as what I would say, running a single DAG on a distributed set of resources is now a much more complex problem where you have a variety of diverse resources. You have a large amounts of data as part of that DAG. And the DAG, I'm going to come to this in a few minutes, which the DAG doesn't look like a DAG anymore either. So this is just a quick refresher for people who may not be as familiar with HPC systems, but traditionally we've had simulation jobs at HPC centers. And in order to run their workflows, users logged in into the system, used a command line interface traditionally to submit a job to a batch queue system that then scheduled the job on the resources. And most of the work around workflow scheduling was about this layer of the batch scheduler, right? Because the infrastructure was sort of a box that they assumed they didn't have any control over. So what's running on HPC systems? What we're realizing more and more is it's really workflows, not just individual jobs, because most of the work that is coming in have these complex dependencies and units of work. And so what users are tending to do is to divide that work up into jobs or put a lot of these processes into a single job, but use the resources with various requirements, right? So to some extent, the original model of considering them as jobs is not sufficient, especially as we go into experimental and observational workflows. So as an example of this, I'm going to talk about the pipeline that LCLS and NERSC worked together, and my team was part of this. It's called the SFX workflow, and it was analyzing and mapping the structure of COVID-19 proteins that was successfully prototyped, ported, and executed on CORI during the pandemic. And there were significant challenges when we were trying to do this, right? The data is generated at LCLS, and they are sort of trying to move the data over the network. And then try to get those nodes in semi-real time at least and spawn those jobs to make this analysis happen before they can decide what the next experiment is, right? So we had to redesign large parts of this workflow because this wasn't a traditional simulation workflow. So it wasn't written for an HPC system. So we had intermediate IO bottlenecks across the stages. The whole pipeline needed to be sort of rethought a little bit to see how this would fit in a NERSC type model. And some of the issues that came up was, the need to support containers so that people could run their same software stack at LCLS as well as NERSC, workflow coordination across the organizations, more urgent computing and real-time data analysis. And the networking and data movement was more critical because there was sort of more time constraints on it. And how does this work with the job queue interaction, right? Where you have this experiment running, generating data that's generating some workflow and parts of the workflow need to run right now. And so it just can't sit in the queue. So trying to figure out how to bring these pieces together was important. So a lot of people, when we talk about real time and sort of just being able to run things immediately, assume that cloud computing would be an appropriate solution here. And funnily, this is where I started my career as an Alvarez Fellow at Berkeley Lab, looking at sort of what the role of cloud computing is in the scientific ecosystem. And we had a big report on from Magellan, which is the name of the project, talking about both the advantages of the cloud environment, but also some of the challenges that came. And one of the key challenges that you see in a cloud environment is that there's significant programming, but there's also significant system administration support, because you sort of need to manage these resources. You need to manage the whole software stack, right? So those are challenges for a resource-constrained scientific project, trying to sort of figure out how to put in additional resources to manage the resources becomes a difficulty. So I'm not going to go into results of this too much. There's a more detailed report there. But some of the sort of experience working with these, what I would call the grid workflows in the early days of scientific workflows, and working on Magellan, which is, you know, looking at sort of the cloud model, led to sort of my early career projects where I was looking at a variety of different things, which, you know, is mirrored a little bit in the community as well, in terms of seeing how we can have a programming model for workflows, right? So it's not just directed acyclic, you know, graphical interface or something like that, but people can just program existing projects, existing sort of applications they have with some patterns of use, right? So you have splits and merges and sequential and parallel are sort of the more common workflow patterns. In addition to that, we were also sort of looking at this aspect of what does it mean to manage data on an HPC system, right? How do you make sure that you're using that a storage hierarchy that is available in an HPC system in your workflow, and how do you do that effectively? So having sort of a virtual data space to map between the user workflow and the storage was a solution we had come up with, I'd say in 2016, 2017 or so. In concert with this, you know, for much of this, we were still assuming the infrastructure was a black box, but we were also beginning to look at sort of, you know, what can we do in the infrastructure, right? How can we set up things so that people have flexibility with how they get their resources? So having them have some elastic resource allocation. So you start out with maybe 10 nodes, and then you can go down to one node, and then you can grow it again as your job grows. And then also looking at how a batch scheduler could be aware of the workflow so that it tries to sort of club this workflow together rather than the individual jobs in a workflow. So that was some of the work that my, you know, my staff, postdoc students and staff were working on, I'd say in sort of 2012 to 2017 or so. But we learned some realities of workflows in that time period. One is they don't actually fit well into DAGs. If you look at the figure that there, this is reality of many of our science projects and many of our desktops too, where we have a lot of squiggly lines and a lot of things we remember in our heads about how they are organized. We also often have artifacts and contexts that are not captured with the workflow, right? So automating that pipeline for running a workflow is great, but if it doesn't fit in with the existing sort of mental model of how all these pieces tie up, and you know, when people write down things in notebooks, making sure we have that metadata available, that becomes important problems that will stop us from the automation. And in addition, like a lot of the large science projects, have complex software stacks, right? So asking them to sort of replace it with a whole new workflow system isn't necessarily practical. So as we were starting to realize some of these problems, we also had started to ask ourselves the question of how do we overcome these problems? And when we build solutions, make sure that they account for the realities of work environments and capture the culture and the context around the science processes. So that's when we came across sort of user research processes. And this is something we've been a big believer of for, and we've been building up the team here at Berkeley Lab. And so user research is used in sort of design of your phones, design of Amazon, and all these websites that we all use every day. But we don't use, we haven't necessarily used it as much in scientific environments before. You know, there have been more recent efforts in the last few years, but this is significantly newer. So what this does is really try to come up with a process to understand users' needs and try to cast it in a very specific context so that it impacts the end product, right? So you have sort of a discover and explore process where, you know, you do interviews, you do contextual inquiry observations, you do competitive analysis to understand why are current methods failing or what are the needs that are unmet at this point. We go on to the next stage of synthesizing this, and there are very there are some standard methods like journey maps, design constraints or considerations that can be given to a team to sort of capture those high level insights that are there. I'm going to talk about that a little bit as we go here. And then, you know, you can design your wireframes or UIs, mockups, prototypes to understand how do you represent the knowledge in a way that makes sense to the user. But from there, you take those back to the user and do usability tests so that you can understand and iterate on it to make the product better. So there's been a lot of research that's shown that this is it results in increased productivity, decreased development costs, increased adoption, and things like that. So we have a team here that's been working alongside with the research team to develop methods that are more specific to science environments and insights that influence what we do. So back in 2017, when we first understood some of these things, we summarized this as 10 principles for creating usable scientific systems. And I don't have the time here to go through all of them because that's a separate talk in itself. But you know what I usually emphasize is it's important to solve the right problem first. It's easy to go to a scientific user, listen to a problem, and pick the problem that's most exciting for us on the computer science or the mathematics side, but trying to understand what's the first problem that they need solved in which one of their cases, the picture that I have, was they really didn't have a data storage solution. They were relying on external hard drives to store, right? So if you don't solve that problem, you're not going to build anything that's useful to the user. It's also important to understand the context of use. So for example, in the Meriflex project in the early days, there was a lot of discussion about, you know, how what does the user interface look like when they're collecting data at a field site? But an important key point that was missed was the fact, the conditions in which the data was being collected. So if you look at that picture there, someone's actually standing in the water trying to collect data, right? So usually with a spotty connection, trying to hold a phone while you're trying to do this to enter data may or may not actually work, right? So it's something to, you know, it's something to understand and something to keep in mind as you go forward. But last but not the least, it's also important to understand the user's metrics. And what am I talking here, right? It's usually, the reality is for more science users, performance is not their metric. So if you look at this, we at the bottom of this, you know, circle here, look at when we're building infrastructure tools, we're looking at performance and efficiency. But when the users look at this, they are going to be thinking about their science result, their science publication, right? So we have cases where users are unwilling to do the optimization that we think they should do because they don't see a benefit to their end science result. You know, we had a user who said, it's great that my code will run in 4 hours, but it's just fine that it runs in 8 hours because I launch my job in the morning and then I go off and do other things and I don't check it till 5 p.m. So what's the advantage of it running by noon because I'm not actually going to check it at 5 p.m., right? So putting in that extra effort is not something the user is going to want to do. So in that context, I think it's important to capture some of what we have learned about user perceptions on HPC systems. We tend to build a lot of abstractions and we think of abstractions as a tool that improves usability, but middleware tools frequently hide which storage system data is located on and associated performance, which is great till something fails and the user has to actually figure out what happened, right? So it's important to make these changes visible and understandable to the user so that they know how to proceed, where there's a transparency on upon demand as a key design goal for the systems and the tools we build. The other, I would say, semi-surprising thing was, we were talking to a lot of users who are fairly experienced in HPC systems. When I say experienced, I mean they've been using HPC systems for 15, 20, 25, 30 years, right? But they all sort of said, but I don't actually know how, I'm a new user to HPC systems, right? Because of the changes in hardware and software configurations, it leads to a certain amount of uncertainty for the users and the IO systems and what is evolving. So there is a little bit of, understanding that we need to develop where we understand that users are perpetually learning how HPC systems function. And we need to sort of figure out how to help them do that. And I talked about this a little bit in terms of new technologies. And this is really hard because, you have a 5-year cycle typically for particular machines, but that doesn't align necessarily with when a beamline is installed or when a large hadron collider comes online. So they are constantly trying to have a least common denominator software stack that works across all systems, right? So even if you have a new technology that you think is wonderful, it may not get adopted because it doesn't actually fit in with what they're trying to do long-term. So these were important lessons for us. And I think more generally for the community in thinking about how we design workflows, systems and tools in general. So more recently, we've been working on sort of taking some of these insights and sort of saying, how do you provide a more robust, scalable, reproducible computing environment where people might use things like Jupyter to be more interactive with the system, with the HPC system, and bring in their tools where they may be bringing their simulation data, as shown in the example there, with materials project, and some experimental data that they're collecting, for example, at a beamline at ALS, to do some data analysis, right? So alongside sort of with the Jupyter interface where, trying to figure out how to make that better for users to run at scale, to be able to scale up existing workflows, to make sure that they have reproducibility. We sort of also have this idea of, being able to retrace what you've done, right? So if you, one of the things about data analysis is it's very iterative as a process. So you do something, you get some results, and then you tweak something and you go back. So how do you roll back? How do you have sort of that checkpoint and provenance so that you have the ability to know where you are, what you've done, but also to roll back to a particular point and also share, because that's a big part of what's happening in our communities where people want to take what they've done and share it with a large number of their collaborators and stuff like that. So that's sort of a focus of a couple of projects that we're working on. So a key element of this, I talked about sharing is, what has changed from the last version you gave me? And so we have a framework that looks at sort of detecting change and capturing that provenance when it comes to data, especially. And this is important because a lot of users are pulling data right now from public sources, from the collaborators, And they get versions of this data, but most often the data doesn't come with that data change lineage, right? So even with very popular data sources like MODIS data and things like that, the users left to decide if the change is significant enough that they need to run the analysis again, or there hasn't been enough change, so they don't need to, right? So there's a bunch of work we did in the deduce project looking at both the mathematical methods to quantify this change, but also to have a user framework that the users can interact with. So the other part of this is search, right? Now we have large amounts of data, and in a realistic world, we want to be able to find the data and not just by this. It's funny, but a lot of scientists tell me, it'd be great if I can just find all my data, and because even that's hard today, let alone trying to find data in a more wider community. So what the biggest challenge to doing this today is, we actually don't have metadata that captures what the data is about, right? So search really doesn't work in the same way, because first, we have data distributed across non-standard ways in lab notebooks and things like that. And second, we just don't have the time or the energy to generate that metadata. And so there is sort of a possibility, a low-hanging fruit that we saw where using ML, machine learning, AI would help us generate this metadata in an effective way. So the science search project that I lead sort of looks at this from multiple dimensions, right? We have metadata extraction, which is based on using deep learning feature analysis from images, for example. But we also look at natural language processing. So we look at the proposals, the papers, the calendar entries at beamlines and things like that. And use natural language processing to sort of extract that metadata because there's a lot of rich metadata in these sources and connecting these up to the data. Another very rich source of metadata is actually in the paths and file names. For example, when I named my file for today, I named it 2022-10, which tells you that this talk was given in 2022 October. And this is true for a lot of our scientific data, where communities actually have standardized file names they come up with. And so you can actually extract that from the path files itself. But at the end of all this, I think the key here is the manual curation or a tagging interface, right? In the end, the validated data, to some extent, because some might say not all scientists validated, put in tags accurately, right? Is the metadata that a user could validate. Like, so the machine generates it and the user goes in and says, yes, no, yes, maybe for each data. So we have a manual curation interface as well. So I, again, would be more than happy to talk to anyone interested in this in more detail. But a large part of this, has been trying to understand the social context of how people use their data, what kind of metadata we can extract from it, but also trying to understand where, the machine learning AI can succeed or where it fails or where it's limited by what we can do without some amount of human input, right? So this is sort of an ongoing project that we have been exploring. And our dream here is to be able to build the Google for scientific data eventually. So I'm going to, I'm looking at the time here a little bit, and I'm going to switch into sort of mode of telling you a little bit about what I'm seeing in my projects and also in the scientific community for where we're headed. But before I do that, I'm going to just take a quick pause and see if anyone has any questions so far.
Hi, Lavanya. I have a question. I think that's a couple of slides before you mentioned that your workflow can actually recover the history of the user's actions, like what we have done. Yeah, the slide, I believe. Is this something that is open, that is available to public? How can we get access to this function?
Sure. We have a tail end of a project. So we do have an open source software. So if you're interested in trying it out, you and I can, Jackie, connect up and we can tell you how we do this. And we'd love to get some feedback too, because, you know, we always want to improve what we're building. So I'd be more than happy to connect with you. But then we do have an early release of this available online.
Okay. I'd be happy to try it out. Thank you.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you, Jackie. All right. If there aren't any other questions, I'm just going to keep talking here. I do promise to stop well in time so that we can have some questions or discussion. So the way I start to see the future is that I think we're going to see a lot more emphasis on self-guiding, a lot of self-driving, both experimental and field observatories as we go on. And they present a significant amount of data and workflow challenges, right? So this example that I'm showing here on the slide, and I take this example because I think it's very interesting and different from some of the other examples that you may hear about. So today, 60 to 90% of water resources originate from mountainous watersheds. So Earth Sciences at LBNL leads sort of this most comprehensive mountainous watershed testbed in the East River in Colorado. So it's important here that we get some fine granularity measurements by changing the setup as we go, since there's a fair amount of uncertainty that comes about from the snowmelt dominated systems that are moving to more low or no snowpacks, right? So in the idealistic world, what we want to do is to be able to control the sensors in that mountainous watershed. And alongside that, run some models on the HPC system, which is feeding, making decisions based on the data it's seeing, but making some decisions on what other things we should be observing. But an interesting part of this is also making sure that there is, you know, we can actually do some controlled experiments, right? So they have what they're setting up is what I would call a more lab type experiment, where it's a controlled environment. And they want to be able to synchronize the field site, the experiment in the lab, the controlled experiment in the lab, and the models to make some real-time decisions on what's going on, right? So this isn't a simple DAG problem. It's a much more complex problem in trying to bring these different pieces together to make some decisions. But in addition to that, we have significant challenges because then there's a very spotty network connectivity at the testbed, right? So ESnet has been deploying sort of a more 5G CBRS system, which will enable some amount of communication and connectivity. But there's some limitations to, you know, we cannot assume that we can always reach the field site. So there's going to have to be sort of a combination of how do you run these models on the edge, and have this data and workflow management and decision-making systems be robust enough to withstand that connectivity issues and operate when possible while leveraging the HPC system, right? So this is an important problem for, you know, some of the climate change studies that are going on, but this isn't limited just to climate change. And National Academics came out with a report earlier this year where they talk about what the community roadmap for scientific workflow research and development needs to look like. And they identify the computing and automation technologies that control the acquisition for data, for example, through the design of new experiments or decision-making as a key element of a workflow problem that's coming up in multiple scientific domains. So this is something we as a community need to be paying attention to. So if you look at this at a high level, what this looks like is really you have the instrument science, which is, you know, how do the instruments, which is the robots or the sensors or the large experiments or the beamlines, how do you have, what level of control you have there? And that is going to be part of this innovation that happens, right? You know, we have used robotics and things like that to some extent in instrument science, but there's some opportunities here in terms of making them more intelligent as we go. There's a key element of this, which is also the intelligent decision-making, which is how do you do digital twins, modeling and simulation, data analysis, active learning. There are a number of projects at Berkeley Lab that's looking at this, including camera, and that's going to be an element of closing this loop. But another key element of this, the one that I'm interested in, is sort of how do you make this distributed workflow work, right? Where you have various entities, various workflows, and how do you make that all come together? And how do you close this loop so that you can keep having innovation, you can keep using these various methods, but have some productivity from for the experimental and observational science. And you know, we see similar challenges. Jackie and I are on this project where these type of loops are becoming important. And how do we build co-design frameworks for next generation microelectronics, right? So in the end, use of AI powered co-design will be important and critical to reduce that time and cost for future designs. But that automation of how do we harness the computational and experimental facilities at LBNL to co-design the next generation microelectronics is an important question. While this picture here shows this nice infinity loop that connects all these pieces, at this point, a lot of these pieces are manual, and all that automation is going to be key long-term for us to have better results from these signs, but also faster turnaround on our solutions. And a key part of this is, you know, of all this infrastructure we build is sort of thinking about what does data services mean in this environment, right? We've largely focused on the HPC centers and compute resources so far, but there's an increased need to figure out what kind of data services exist and how do they interact with the computational resources to provide sort of a seamless environment so that anybody starting, you know, an experiment in the beamline can harness, store the data, run their compute, make some real-time decisions, and continue that process when they go offline from the experiment to do more detailed analysis, right? So that every step is not trying to reinvent that software stack as we go. So as a summary, you know, I think of automation and programmable infrastructure as being some key challenges for next generation workflows in a very different world from where I started my career, where we really had HPC systems, we had the network, and that was it. Now you have more vertical layers here where you have the experiment and observation data coming in. You have edge computing, which brings the edge resources, FPGAs, things like that. The network is much smarter now. You have the ability to data cache, you have science DMZs. So leveraging that is important. But we're also seeing sort of this layer of services coming in between the HPC system and network, you know, which may be containers, Jupyter Hub gateways, data transfer nodes, workflow and data services, things like that, which makes this problem a lot more complex. And in addition to that, we are seeing an evolution in the infrastructure itself, where, you know, the resource infrastructure is diverse. And so the scheduling need considerations need to consider the wide area. Software is going to play a much more key role than, you know, it was enough to provide an MPI set of MPI libraries and a few key libraries at HPC centers. And that's no longer sufficient because you need all these data management and workflow tools across the spectrum, but especially at an HPC center. And we have the need for that self-driving responsiveness and autonomous needs of science that we need to address. So, none of this would have been possible without the help of many people, many staff and collaborators on various projects, and also NERSC and DOE that funds a majority of my work. So at this point, I would love to take some questions and just open up for discussion.
Thank you, Lavanya. Do we have questions from the audience? Yes, Aaron.
Hello, not a question, just a comment. As someone who is very new to the research world, I'm a new security engineer here at NERSC. Very experienced with security, it's still pretty green in the research world. This gave me exactly what I was hoping for, better understanding of the workflows in particular that researchers are trying to accomplish. So thank you very much for that. That's given me a lot of context.
Oh, thank you for saying that, Aaron. I do appreciate your comment. I'm glad it was useful.
Do we have other questions or comments from the audience? If not, I also have another question, because I don't have any background knowledge of edge computing and cloud computing. I hear people talking about this too a lot, but it's very hard for me to understand the difference and maybe connection between these two. Could you give me some context of this?
Sure. Cloud computing is really a business model, right? So the big companies have come together and they have put machines on their floor and have decided they can sell that to people and get money out of it, right? The advantage of this is for a lot of companies, that means they don't have the capital costs, right? So you don't have to get space, you don't have to get power, you don't have to quit cooling, and somebody is doing this for you, right? And so it's a much more, I'd say, a model to consolidate infrastructure to allow various people to get it. But there is a part of cloud computing, which is also, a different software stack than what we've run at HPC centers, which focuses more on giving users the flexibility so that, you pretty much get a set of machines and then you can configure it whatever way you want and run whatever you need on it, right? So you control the operating system, you control the software stack on it, and you can decide how you want to configure it. And this is great for an environment, like companies like Netflix and, who have software engineers who use Amazon or Google or one of the other cloud providers, right? Because they are effectively computer engineers. And so they're, instead of operating their own infrastructure, they can operate it. For a science environment, it's not out of the box, right? Somebody in the middle still needs to build that software stack, still needs to manage those resources. There are also cost considerations and stuff like that come into play. So edge computing is much more, I'd say, a model of, can you have some set of compute resources close to the machine, close to where the data is generated, so that you could make some quick calculations, right? So it's not a full-fledged data center, it's a small set of resources. Both edge computing and cloud computing, I think, the words have emerged in, the more the business or the commercial context. And I find sometimes in our context, different people mean different things by cloud computing, right? Or different people mean different things by edge. But for me, the edge is sort of the closest to a compute center or an experimental facility where there's a small set of nodes with some specialized ability to do certain things, right? So you could think of edge computing as a small, the FPGA nodes close to ALS. So it does some amount of data compression or something like that before it actually gets on the network. Whereas cloud computing is just another computing model.
Got it.
Does that help?
Yeah, it helps a lot. So if I'm going to simplify mine, it just because I just want to have a one sentence understanding of this. Cloud computing is the physical distance of the cloud computer is longer, much longer than the edge computers, if that's a word. And cloud computer would need an internet access, while edge computer does not.
It would be the local internet, right? Like, again, it's not the wide area network, but it's the local.
Okay, great. Do we have other questions or comments from the audience? All right, great. Thank you everyone for joining. I'd like to call it a session for today. Thank you, Lavanya, for the fantastic talk.
Thanks everyone for coming today. Thank you, bye-bye.
Bye.